Hey folks, so today I'm going to be working on my master bathroom, and I'm actually working on finishing up a shower enclosure. So one of the things I'm creating, and I've stepped into it, is a 6x6 shower that two adults can use at the same time. Has a common floor drain. It has an attachment for a hand shower, but there's one shower on this wall and one shower on that wall. Makes it a really nice shower. So one of the features I decided I wanted to add to this shower was a steam generator, and it's going to go in the half bath that's on the other side of this wall. And so, you know, with a steam shower, it's going to generate a lot of steam. So I have put an oversized fan. It's a Panasonic fan that's up right here. And that'll get the steam out of the bathroom when it's appropriate. And I've also insulated all the walls with closed cell spray foam. I have the machine, so why not? But when it came to this door, I didn't want to spend an exorbitant amount of money on a piece of glass to go here. So I'm going to use a standard shower door. And if that doesn't work, I'll end up putting a piece of glass in. But so what I'm doing is I'm just framing the entrance down so the standard door will fill this entrance. Well, so I've got this frame, but now I need to measure and put some backer board here, and then I need to put sheetrock on this side. Now, I'm probably not going to insulate this because it just doesn't really matter if that one spot's not insulated. But I decided I'd go ahead and shoot some video of it. So that's what today's project is. Start from this side. Never completely trust. Yeah, that'll fit. So I measure top and bottom. I'm gonna measure here, 19 5/8. All right, so I've got my measurements. It's 19 5/8 tall by, I wanna say it was, I'm gonna remeasure this, 51 1/2. Yeah. Oh, 61 1/2. So it's a little bit over 5 feet. Damn it. So let me go make some pieces of backer board and I'll come back. Okay, so that completes attaching the first board. I've got another little board over here. I'm going to reuse this for the sheetrock. I'm using my rigid R4512 palm driver. If you're curious about this, check out my other video. I have a video review of it. You know, it's not my go-to tool, but there are certain situations it's extremely useful for, like what you just saw, where I need a Torx bit for just a couple of screws. This is perfect. Saves me from having to change bits in my other drill. So I'll go ahead and measure this. Go ahead, cut that, and I'll be back in just a few. All right, so I've got my piece trimmed. I'm gonna put my ear protection on, and I will put this in place. one more for the heck of it. Can't really have too many screws in this stuff. Got a little bit more material here, across there, and there. This will be the last piece to go in, and the reason it'll be last is because I'll probably put a ledger board here when I start doing my tile. It'll make my life a lot simpler, and then I can just kind of fill in around it. So I'll go ahead and cut these pieces and put them in, let you guys watch. I will be using some metal trim to terminate here, but it'll be tile from there on in. And so what I need to do now is measure this. I always hate working with these little pieces because they have a strong tendency to split. On the bright side, they're typically scrap. 19.5 by 2.25. Yeah, that's gonna be real fun. All right, so let me go get that cut. So this is gonna be such a small piece to try and cut laterally. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put it in here and then I'm gonna sacrifice the Sawzall blade on it. Hate to waste a Sawzall blade, but you know, it's just really critical to work safely in situations like this. And it's real difficult to cut a 2.25-inch piece of hardy trim and then have it stay together. Go ahead and put a few screws in this. Should be wearing my hearing protection, but you know, I'm only doing 4 screws, so it's not a big deal. All right, so let me go find my Sawzall. So I've got plenty of personal protective equipment for this. So I'm gonna put my mask on. This is a 3M full face respirator.
The dust from this can cause silicosis, so it's fairly serious stuff. As good of a fit as you can get.
Unfortunately, it absolutely destroys the Sawzall blade when you cut the stuff with it, so that blade's gonna go in the trash. The good news is that blade has been around the block a couple times, so not really missing much here. And then I just need to measure these and cut these two pieces here, and that'll wrap this project. So 4.5. All right, so it's 4.5 and it's about 70 something tall. So the way I'm gonna handle this is I'm just gonna go look through my scrap and see what I've got. And if I need to, I'll just cut a full length piece that's 4.5. Back in a few. All right, so I've got my first piece cut. Sometimes the sockets are malformed on these, in which case they just won't screw in. That's okay, they're recyclable. All right, so that's done. Now what I need to do is measure this last piece, see how tall it is. 11 and a half. Okay, so I decided to go ahead and cut this the second side first because I'm trying to maximize my materialization. It's easier to get a 4.5 strip inch strip out of it. So that completes that. I want to measure this side. All right, so I've got to go do some more cutting and I'll be back in a minute. Okay, friends, I've got my two small pieces cut. So I'm gonna go ahead and put my hearing protection in and get these placed. Extremely happy with my DeWalt Max XR. These are the most durable tools I've ever owned. And, you watched me put 60 screws in. I haven't even put a dent in the battery yet. I typically get a half day out of these batteries, or if I'm using them to drive screws, I get a couple hours out of each charge. All right, so that's it for putting that in. Now I've got some sheetrock to cut on the other side, so let me get set up for that outside and I'll cut that sheetrock and bring it in. All right, so I've got my piece of sheetrock measured and cut. I have gone ahead and pre-fitted it because it takes a little bit of trimming. You know, it's a 50-year-old house, so there's nothing that's perfectly square in it. Although it is an extremely well-built house. So for this, I'll be using my DeWalt screwdriver with a collating attachment. I've got another video on this if you're interested in how it works. The screws are a little more expensive, but it is a huge time saver, and so it is fantastic. I've done the entire house with it, and it has saved me countless hours of labor. All right. All right, so now I need to mark, I need a pencil. To mark where these studs are. Now I'll go ahead and remove my helping hands here. So you can take some of the guesswork out of this with a square. That'll get me really close. Might have missed that one. definitely missed that one. All right, so at this point, what I gotta do is what I call finishing screws. So like I've got one here that's not quite in. And I check them by feel. So I missed that one, and I really feel like I could put it here. All that's left to do is to tape and mud in both sides. The inside gets a thin set mixture, the outside gets drywall mud. I'll go ahead and tape these seams then I'll mud it up. So let me get that stuff mixed up and I'll be back in a minute. Okay, so I've changed the angle of camera so you guys can see what I'm actually doing. I'm using fiberglass mesh tape in combination with what's often called hot mud. So hot mud is a powdered mix that you add water to and mix up. Now I'm using 20 minute because I just don't have that much mud to do. And what I really like about it is it dries real hard and it has the same consistency as the sheetrock once it's dry. And I really need to scrape this a little bit. So I used green board in the bulk of the bathrooms, but the reality is that's just a slightly different paper. They put wax in the paper. It doesn't actually do anything. And I have a large fan in this bathroom and I'm conscious of moisture management, humidity management in the house. So I'm really not worried about mold or mildew on my sheetrock because I'm just not gonna let the moisture accumulate. And that's ultimately the right solution. Because this house is insulated with spray foam, it's just critical to constantly manage the humidity levels and moisture inside the house. So now that I found the end of this, I'll go ahead and start taping. You know, I often used to wonder about the strength of this, and in my old house, I remodeled an extension to the house, and I had to take this stuff out, and I gotta tell you, this stuff is strong as heck. All right. So that's taped. Now, on the inside, I need to use a different tape. This is an alkali-resistant tape, and it will resist the acids that are in the thin set. And a lot of people skip this step when they do a shower, and the problem is, now you got two pieces of substrate, they'll move, it'll cause cracks. So, and when I say move, they'll expand and contract. So if you put some tape in there and you put some thin set in there, it'll mechanically bond the two sections. Don't do this to the corners though. In the corners, you want to use silicone and you want to caulk the corners. And what you do is once the corners are caulked, you come back and overlay a different mesh with red guard. In fact, it's this mesh here, and this is just a fiberglass mesh. And what this does is, and you could use this in a pinch, but what that does is it just reinforces these corners. Again, these are the things that people typically don't do. And so if you're hiring somebody, you want to make sure they're using a liquid applied water and moisture barrier. Red Guard, there's several other options out there. Laticrete makes something. I like Red Guard, goes on paint. Pink, it dries red. You want to make sure they are taping and floating your seams. It's not, I don't think it's good enough to do it when you put the tile up. Your water vapor should be, your barrier should be up. I mean, you know, yeah, you could put plastic behind this, but the problem with that is now all this gets wet and holds moisture. You know, if there is a hole in the back of it, now the moisture has somewhere to go. What I like about this is all the screws and all the material behind it is sealed. So it's just the tile and the thin set for the tile that get wet. And I've been real happy with my results. Let me go get a flashlight. You know, the problem with doing it right is it takes longer. And so there are contractors out there that just want to get it done because the sooner they get it done, the sooner they get paid. And that's right, but you know, you need to make sure it's done right. Because if it's not done right, now you're gonna have to try and find that contractor and get them back out to fix it. And if you're dealing with, you know, Joe's fly-by-night tile, you may never see that joker again. So when your stuff starts leaking, he's already cashed your check and run off to another job, and he ain't coming back. And, you know, so I just hate it when people cut corners on stuff like this. So I got one that's a little bit high. Let me go get the tool for that. So I've got my mud mixed up, and I'm going to go ahead and float these joints real fast. And there's a little bit of a lump here, so the first coat's not going to get it, but the second coat will. Thank you. going to get crown molding, so it doesn't actually have to be perfect. It just should be there. Really don't even need to float this joint because I am going to do crown molding. But that's how I did the rest of the house, so I'm going to be consistent. And the only reason I floated the ceiling joint on the rest of the house is because I knew I would have to look at it for a year before I got around to being able to do crown molding. All right, so thanks for watching. I hope you found this interesting, and I will try to post more blogs of my progress on the house. And that completes this project. So I've put up the sheetrock, put up the backer board. I have taken care of the joints on the backer board. And now what I need to do is go clean up real quick before this starts to set. I only have about 15 minutes of working time on it. Again, thanks for watching.